it's Dan Knifer here from CFS Unraveled, and I'm here to bring you another fibromyalgia recovery story. It's my pleasure this evening to bring to you a story with Katina Makris. Katina is in the eastern side of the United States, which I'm sure you'll recognize from my accent in a moment. Katina, welcome and thank you for sharing your story.
Oh, thank you, Dan. It's wonderful to be with you all, and it's my pleasure to be able to give people hope and inspiration.
You know, Katina, I've said this often in my recovery interviews. It can be quite hard to find people who've recovered on the internet. And having spoken to many people that have recovered, including those that don't share their stories, I'm getting a bit more of a deeper understanding of why that happens. But I'm curious. First of all, I want to say thank you for sharing your story, but I'm also curious to see why is it that you think that people are not always sharing their stories on the internet?
Well, I think some people are shy by nature, and they don't really, you know, want to open their hearts and you know, share some of the privacy and some of the, I think, emotional difficulties in particular that go along with these kind of illnesses. Mm. And so there's a certain reserve, I think, amongst certain folks. I happen to be an extrovert, and I like people a lot, and so it's not as hard, I think, for me maybe to talk about what I went through and my experience and my feelings.
Yes.
And I think also maybe another point, which you probably are aware of, is that I think some people, when they get well, they just kind of merrily go along and get back into living, and maybe they don't, you know, want to look back to where they've been.
Yes.
But I think perspective is very important in life, and we have a lot of lessons that we learn from the journeys we make, and if healing is to be achieved, I think perspective is important. So I'm happy to share.
Yeah, look, I really appreciate that. And you know, that is my view too. I found many people, they want to close that chapter of their life. You know, they want to just put it behind them and just not think about it. I think, and it is very private. I remember when I first started to share it, it was quite a mixed thing for me, because I'm a private person by nature, and you talk about some very intimate things when inevitable, because this illness is so severe and has such an impact. So I think it's always brave for people to share their story. And I hope anyone who's listening will perhaps consider the huge impact it can have on somebody to hear a story of recovery. Because I think one of the biggest challenges for people is the whole thing of, you know, you think no one can recover. So you think it's not possible. And if you don't think it's possible, well, there's no point trying. Well, let's start to get into your story. Tell me, Katina, when did you first start to get unwell? When did you know something was wrong? Was it many years ago?
Yeah, it was. It was in the summer of 2000.
Right.
So that's 13 years ago now. And I was a very healthy person prior to that. I was always very physically active and lived outside in the country and was, you know, athletic and young children and organic food. And I worked in the world of natural medicine, so I took good care of myself. And I got very sick one summer with what seemed to be a flu.
Right.
And it did not clear up the way we would think it would. It was 6 weeks later, and I still did not feel well. And I was in and out of the doctor's office, and they said, oh, well, you know, just rest. You know, we'll see. I'm sure you're going to get better. And I did get a little bit better after 6 weeks. But as the month continued and we got into the winter season here up in my area of the world, I was like quasi bedridden. You know, it was really hard for me. I had no energy. I had terrible muscle pains in my neck and shoulders and back and legs. It was difficult just to even, you know, get to the shower or up or down the stairs.
Mm.
And finally, after about 6 months of this, I went to the warm weather, the state of Florida, which you probably know, mm-hmm. has beautiful sunny beaches, and my father had a place there to stay, and I stayed for a month. And the sunshine and the ocean water seemed to really do a lot for me, and I came home, and I thought, great, we got that out of my system. I, you know, whatever that bad bug was, I'm well now. And so I came home with a really fresh attitude and figured I'd be back to work and, you know, everything would be going along merrily. But within about 2 months, I was riddled again with all the symptoms, the depression, the violent headaches, all these, you know, terrible body pains and the profound weakness. And finally, you know, many doctors and hospitals to come, I was labeled with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia.
Right.
With a migraine component to it.
Right.
And so that's what I was struggling with for a very long time.
Tell me, Katina, you know, middle of summer, getting a flu, seems a bit of an odd time to get the flu, isn't it?
Yeah.
Did you, when it happened, sort of think, this is a bit unusual, getting a flu in the middle of summer?
Did that cross
your mind? Yes.
I did, and I had a vertigo with it. It had a dizzy vertigo component with it, and I was perplexed because I'm a homeopathic practitioner. Right. I don't know if you know that discipline, but there is remedies for summertime flus. Mm-hmm. And so I took those remedies thinking, oh, great, that will help this kind of summertime flu with all these body pains. Mm. And I did not respond very well to the remedy. And the doctor at the time said, well, you know how it can be with these strange viruses. You know, it'll just pass. And then at one point they even tossed around maybe it was walking pneumonia.
Right.
Because I was so weak.
Yes.
And I was thinking, really? I've never had anything like bronchitis or pneumonia or strep. I was unusually healthy. So it was, yes, it did strike me as very unusual. But then again, you know, people do get things in the summertime, meningitis and,
sure.
you know, other things. But what was more perplexing for me was that as it's year two and it's year three and I'm still no better, and I'm taking acupuncture, and I'm getting a little bit better, or I'm, you know, visiting doctors, and they're rotating the migraine medicines, and they're trying to find ways to modify my symptoms. But I just, inside of myself, I just kept saying, this can't be so. Why do I have fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome? I took really good care of myself. Why did I get so run down?
Yes. Yes. So well, look, and the why questions are the most powerful ones, I find. So I appreciate you asking that question. Tell me, you know, did your symptoms evolve over time? Did you find that that you started getting additional symptoms, or that you changed? And what kind of other symptoms besides the fatigue and the pain and the flu symptoms? Did you have any other sort of problems with your gut or orthostatic intolerance or?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
You pinpointed it exactly. What started happening, you know, after that fatigue and the muscle pains and the migraines was I started getting digestive issues like irritable bowel syndrome and constant burning like at the top of my stomach area up there, you know, in the area where people get heartburn. But it was different. It was like a knife, and I could tolerate just the simplest of foods. Anything would set me off. And then I also had a very strange sleep patterns. Mm-hmm. You know, I would either not fall asleep and I'd be up all hours and then fall asleep like at 3 a.m. and then want to sleep till like 11, or I'd fall right asleep and then I'd be wide awake at 3, and I'd have these very strange sleep patterns. And then I started with anxiety attacks, which would just start in the lower kind of area of my body, like down below my belly button. Mm-hmm. And it would feel like this anxiety was like racing around inside of me, and it would race up into my chest, and then it would get up into my head, and my mind would just feel like it was swirling. And, it was very frightening to me because I'd never experienced anything like that. And it could happen, you know, just like watching a video with my children or lying in the bathtub, or sometimes it would even like wake me up out of my sleep. And so that was a very frightening time for me, and I thought, am I going crazy? And, you know, the doctors gave me some anti-anxiety medicine for a while, and then we tried some of the different antidepressant medicines, which I didn't tolerate at all. Didn't blend with my body, and but I had awful depression, Dan, especially in the cold winter months.
Yes.
Because I was locked up at home, really. I mean, you know, I couldn't drive or get into town to see people, and the isolation I think that people feel with these kinds of illnesses is very real.
Look, I think that's so true, and I appreciate you sharing that, because the isolation it's got multiple layers. I mean, one, there's the physical isolation because you can't get out. But I think it's also so isolating because even when you're with people, because people don't really understand what you're going through, it's isolating. And because often we're not understood. We're not understood by our family. We're not often understood by the doctors. And it's easy to see why. I mean, if you're looking at all the symptoms you're telling me, and then you're telling me you've got these anxiety issues, and you go to me as a doctor, well, you know, maybe you can see how they think you're a crazy person.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, of course, we get very skeptical and angry about people treating us this way, because it's like, you know, you know that's not the case. But if we put ourselves in their shoes for a moment, you can sort of see, well, you know, she's got these anxiety issues, she's depressed, she's telling me she's got all kinds of weird. What, tell me, did you have any other, I mean, you've got all these symptoms already, I'm not saying it isn't enough, but did you have any other weird or strange symptoms?
I did. I would get these weird racing things in my heart, like
palpitations
or like a sudden skip.
Yes.
And I wore the halter monitor for a while, and they monitored my heart rate.
Yeah.
I had these other, like a very high-pitched sound, like I could hear this high frequency noise, and I would say to my children or and someone in my family, like, do you hear that? Do you hear that high buzz?
Yes.
And they're like, no, we don't hear it. And you know, I had odd symptoms like that.
Did you ever have smell sensations? Strange smell sensations?
I didn't have that one, blessedly.
Okay.
I did have the terrible though, you know, you get up from sitting.
Yes.
And it would just feel like you were going to faint.
Yes.
You know, or from lying, I mean, my blood pressure would just drop so quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And then eventually, you know, we're going into year 4 and approaching year 5, and I'm getting like palsies, like tremors.
Right.
I was starting to get tremors, especially in my legs and my feet. And then I got really frightened after I'd been to several neurologists and they couldn't tell me what was wrong with me. I got foot drop, like with MS, so that I, you know, when I go to climb the stairs, like my foot, the muscle wouldn't work to lift the foot properly. So I was getting a lot of strange symptoms and, you know, odd pains, like you said. And, you know, every year there seemed to be something new to the equation.
And I think this is the problem is that not only is the illness severe and not only is it widespread, but it's changing. It's a moving target. And not just in terms of treatments and symptoms, but, you know, obviously when you come up with all these ideas of, you know, all these symptoms and things and no one quite knows what it is, you were obviously lucky enough to be actually diagnosed early on with chronic fatigue and fibromyalgia, but many people are not. And because they keep going back with new, weird and wacky symptoms, it's so easy to feel like you're being a hypochondriac. And I remember that feeling. It's like they're already looking at you and sometimes, you know, rolling their eyes, or sometimes you feel like they're rolling their eyes internally. They're not actually rolling their eyes in front of you, but you're sort of looking at them, you think they're doing it. And you feel that way, don't you? I mean, you actually feel like you're being a hypochondriac, because it's almost embarrassing to come up with this next weird symptom. It just doesn't sound that plausible.
I know. It's really, I have such empathy for everyone who has any constellation of the symptoms that you and I have been talking about.
Yes.
And are trying to get help, whether it's through the medical system or through family support or whatever, because sometimes on the outside you look pretty normal.
Absolutely.
But inside your body is going through all of these, you know, oddities, and the symptoms, I think, are an expression of the imbalances that we're struggling with. And because I do, you know, come from a world of natural medicine, I do understand about some of the physiology.
Yes.
And, you know, one of the big pieces that was part of my recovery process was understanding the role of the adrenal glands.
Yes, yes.
And that seems to be a common thread amongst everyone that's suffering with fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue syndrome, Lyme disease, a lot of these other autoimmune disorders, is the adrenal glands.
Absolutely.
So depleted, and they can't make the hormones they need or the anti-inflammatory steroids, and they can't make enough, you know, cortisol and all of these things.
Yes.
And so then it's like a symphony. The adrenal glands are part of the endocrine system, which is, you know, the thyroid and the thymus and the pituitary, and I equate it to being like in an orchestra. And if the woodwinds are not coming in at the right time, then that doesn't cue the brass, you know, horns to come in, and the whole symphony sounds disharmonious. And I think, you know, that's the metaphor I use for what we're experiencing with these conditions, is if the adrenal glands get overtaxed and the poor things can't make enough of the proper hormones and, you know, other biochemicals, well, then the pituitary goes off and you don't have a right sleep cycle, and then your thyroid's off and you don't metabolize your food and make energy, and, you know, the whole thing, the immune
thymus can't make it, doesn't it? It gets very involved and very complex, and at the end of the day, I guess we, you know, it gets very complex trying to account for all of the symptoms. But let me take you, before we get into your recovery, Katina, and I know people will be very interested to hear how you made and when you made the change, and I'll talk to ask you about that in a moment. But first, let me ask you this. What happened immediately before you got sick? Did anything happen in your life immediately before you got sick?
Well, not like in the days and weeks before I got sick, but if I look back, you know, over the couple of years before I got sick, I had, I would say, a lot of pressure that I was juggling. I was a new mother for the first time at age 39, and we lived, as I said, an outdoor lifestyle, so we had, you know, our house we heated all with wood, so there was a lot of physical demands, and a large organic garden and chickens. And, you know, kind of just physical work, that's okay. But I also had two practices, homeopathic offices that I maintained, and I wrote a health column, and my husband traveled extensively around the world, so I was home alone with the children and the house and the job. And if I look back, I can see that I was multitasking and really, you know, carrying an enormous amount of pressure, but didn't even, like, think twice about it. I just kept doing it. You know, I just kept those, like, the juggler. I kept the balls up in the air and
kept pushing.
I never really let down.
Right. 2 years, I suppose many people can relate to that. Now, I suppose this is quite a kind of a reflection of many people's busy lifestyles these days, where we maybe take on a little bit more than we can manage sometimes. But tell me, were there any other events, were there any other life events besides this busy time? Can you think in a couple of years preceding to that? Did you have any?
My mother died, let's think. My mother died 3 years prior.
Right.
And I was very close to her, so, and I nursed her through her last 3 months of her illness. She had cancer, and I was, my father and I were her primary caregivers. So I recall, you know, caring for her on my own sometimes, sleeping with my ear open, you know, right. to, if I could, if she needed help in the night, or, you know, I'd be kind of in that watchful mode of really not a deep sleep. Right. And I think, you know, that probably was a big a component too of another challenge.
Yes.
And it was a big loss too. I was very close to my mother, and I'm sure it affected me, even if I didn't, you know in the long run, because then I had a baby of my own within the year.
Right.
So it was a mixture of sadness of losing my mother, but then joy of a newborn. So
right.
It probably was quite a bit for me in reflection.
How was your, last 3 months, did you say, of her life that you were looking after her? Right. So I suppose you were, when you say you were listening out at night in case she needed help, was that what was going on, or...
Yeah. I would, you know, I'd sleep like a mother does with their baby. Like, you keep an ear open to
right.
hear if you hear a cry in the night.
Yes.
It's a light kind of sleep, and it was the same kind of thing with my mother. I would, you know, I'd have, even though it was an intercom, you know, there was like this on alert kind of.
Sure.
Of energy. Of,
it's like you're always ready to jump out of bed.
Yes.
That's not where to sleep.
No, and I can recall actually afterwards, after she did pass away, that I had a hard time getting back to a regular, you know, sleep cycle of a deep sleep and not having the waking ear. And I actually went to a hypnotherapist to see if they could help me sleep better.
What about the birth of your child? Was it a good pregnancy? Was it a reasonable pregnancy? Was the birth went pretty smoothly, or?
No, it was complicated. The first two trimesters were fine, and then the last trimester, I had probably what we would, you know, in hindsight, look back and say could have been some symptoms, because I had overwhelming fatigue. I had terrible sleep problem again, and then I developed that preeclampsia, which is the elevated blood pressure.
Mm-hmm.
And then my son was 2 weeks late,
right.
And they didn't like it because my blood pressure was elevated.
Mm-hmm.
So they tried to induce me with hormones. And by now, you know, I'm older, too. I'm almost 40, right? So my body didn't really respond to that, and we ended up having a cesarean section. And my son is fine,
mm-hmm.
blessedly, but I did have a strange third trimester.
Okay. For those listening, if you haven't heard of preeclampsia, it's also sometimes called toxemia, and it is a condition that normally mainly occurs in first birth for children. It's quite rare, but it can be very, very severe and can be quite dangerous. Did you recover well from that? Did it take long for your blood levels did your bloods return back to normal within a reasonable time?
Yes, in about 6 weeks I was back to myself.
Very good.
Yeah, I was back to myself and doing very well. I remember it was summertime and riding my bicycle with the baby
yes.
in the nice. Back. And I recovered quite nicely. And, you know, I had then 3 years, and then that 3 years
yes.
later was the summer I got ill.
That's all right. Okay. All right. Well, look, that gives us a good run-up. So you obviously you got ill in 2000, and obviously, it sounded for the next 3-4 years, you were telling us that you got more and more symptoms, not less, and more severe at times, and stranger. Tell me, when would you say was your turning point with the illness? Was there a point that you remember? I mean, before I go to the turning point, let me ask you the other question. Did you think you would recover after 4 years?
Well, no. Well, I had, it was actually in year 5 that I was rock bottom.
Right.
I had not been out of my bed or off of the sofa in over a year. And so year 4 into solid year 5, I was just really thinking I was going to die or this was an illness they hadn't diagnosed yet and that I was just going to deteriorate. And it was very, very upsetting for me. And by now, you can imagine, 5 years into this, I've lost my career, my income, my marriage had crumbled, and I was on the verge of losing my home, which I ended up having to sell to pay for medical expenses. And I would cry on the phone to my father, and he was a wonderful inspiration to me. He'd survived World War II. He'd been left for dead in the jungles of the Philippines, and he was found by medics, and, you know, he was a real survivor, and he had other incidences in his life that he, you know, died and saw the white light but came back. And so, you know, when I was crying on the phone to him, and I'd say, Daddy, I just don't think I can make it, and it's so hard, and, you know, sometimes I think maybe it would be easier if I just died. I mean, you know, that's how miserable I was.
Yeah.
And he would say, you can't die. You have to fight. He says, look at that, what happened to me. They told me I was dead, and I fought back, and I lived. He says, if I could do that, you can do this. And he says, you have a young son, and only you know how to love him, and you have to be there. You cannot give in to this. And he says, who cares what the doctors say? They don't know everything, and you can heal. He would give me these pep talks.
Yes. Yes.
And he said, you have to use the power of your mind, and you have to use your will, and you have to see yourself healthy. And so he started me with these little exercises where we were on the telephone, and he would say, close your eyes, now pick a place that you love that's beautiful. And there's this beautiful beach in the Bahamas that I love. And he'd say, okay, now tell me what you're doing. And, you know, I'd tell him I'm floating in the water or I'm lying in the sun. And he, you know, create this image with me.
Right.
And then he'd say, okay, now that is the power of positive thinking.
Yes.
And he says, you need to go to that sunny beach and you need to visit it every day, like 3 or 4 or 5 times a day. He says, you've got to turn your body around.
Yes.
And he says, the mind is the most incredible gift that we have been given. He used to say, God gave you a mind and you need to use it.
Yes.
And he said, these negative thoughts that the doctors are telling you that you're going to have to live with this forever and that, you know, they don't have any clear answers. He says, well, you just got to give that up. I can, like, hear them.
Yes.
And those were my darkest times. And my dad's, visualizations and intentions were the only things that kind of, like, I held on to, plus my beautiful son, who was just like a 7-year-old and an 8-year-old, and he would be so darling, bouncing in from school with his big blue eyes, and we'd lie on the sofa and play backgammon together. Or, you know, I just had these small moments at bedtime where I would just say, oh, these are the best moments of my day, because there was love, you know?
Yes.
And then I had a turning point, which is, if you'd like me to share, this was the turning point of my story. It was one of those difficult days where I was so down and blue, and it was, again, in the summer, and my son was off at summer camp for the day, and I just was crying, and I just didn't think I could hold on. And I all of a sudden I had this feeling, like, inside of me that I needed to get up to my bookcase upstairs in the art studio where I had a book from India on clinical homeopathy.
Right.
And in my thought process was, oh my gosh, those homeopaths from India, they have such knowledge. And maybe there's something in that book. There'll be a remedy for me that can help me with this fatigue and these pains and these migraines and this fibromyalgia. And so I went crawling, Dan, because that's how weak I was, crawling across the floor with the dog, like, on my heels, like, where's mommy going, you know, and up the stairs, and I made it to the top, and I'm crawling to the bookcase, and I get the book.
Yeah.
And when I open it, I open to the front page, and there's an inscription in pen from a homeopath, a colleague that had given me the book like 10 years ago, and it said, to one homeopath from another, may blue skies, health, and happiness fill your life always. And it was signed by his name. And I said, oh my gosh, I totally forgot about him. He'll know what to do with me.
Yeah.
Because we used to share difficult cases with one another.
Right.
And so I tucked the book under my arm and I went crawling back down the stairs and I called his office, and usually it was like a 2-month wait list to get in. And the secretary blessedly said, oh my gosh, Katina, we have a cancellation in 2 weeks. Would you like to take it? And I said, yes, please, please. And so it was an hour away to his office, and a friend brought me over. And I'm like, you know, reclined in the car because I can't even sit up. I mean, that's, you know, how debilitated I was. And we kind of limped me into the office, and I'm sharing this whole story with him, my 5 years, and my blood work, and, you know, labs, and all these things to show him. And I'm about halfway, you know, into my visit with him, about 30 minutes, and he says to me, have you been tested for Lyme disease? And I said, yes, 3 times, and it was negative. And he said, let me see your blood work, and I handed it to him, and he says, well, this is not the right lab to use. This is the lab that everyone uses, and there's a 70% error rate. And he says, I believe this is Lyme disease, and it's advanced. It's moved from your bloodstream to your muscles and your joints, and it's into your neurological system, and I want to do some specialty tests. And I was thinking, what? Lyme disease? I never saw a tick, because it's the little insect that carries it. I never saw a tick on my body. And he said, well, you know, you don't always see them. They're tiny when they're babies, or it could be in your scalp, and it was the summer when you got sick. And so sure enough, he ran the specialty test out of the lab from California, which was the only one in the United States running these advanced, you know, tests that you paid special out-of-pocket for, our insurance would not cover. And 2 weeks later, when I came back, he showed me the paperwork, and it was at the tippy top of the chart, Dan.
Right.
Like, you could not get a more positive test.
Right.
And I was, like, so, like, elated and also, like, furious at the same time. I was, like, elated because I knew I was not imagining all of these difficulties.
Sure.
And these 5 years of my life that eroded. And then I was, like, furious, like, why did people not know about these labs, and why do they not know about this illness, and why does it look like Lyme and fibromyalgia and Lyme and MS and Lyme and migraines and, you know, this whole kind of thing?
A lot of these illnesses do overlap, and but that's not to say that you didn't have both.
Exactly. And so he did further testing, and he, as a specialty clinical nutritionist, who I consider really to be quite a genius, this fellow, he was 25 years in practice at this point. He did a lot of specialty tests, and he discovered I had a mitochondria dysfunction, and he discovered I had a mold toxicity, and then I also had something with my neurotransmitters that wouldn't regulate properly. You know, he found a lot of these syndromes.
Yeah, often we find in chronic fatigue syndrome, also called myalgic encephalomyelitis in Europe, that a lot of the neurotransmitters are not working correctly. Besides the levels in the brain, even if you look in the spinal column, you'll find elevated levels of substance P. So there are a lot of tests that show that there's really, you know, a lot of problems and dysfunctions in CFS and fibromyalgia. It's just they're not common tests, and they don't necessarily transfer to, well, here's the problem, here's a treatment, because of the way the illness works. But yes, the tests do exist to show all these problems. It's just they're not standardly done because they do not translate to a treatment that will fix all the problems, and hence
right.
Those tests are not done. So yes, but anyway, go on. You obviously at least you're getting some and at least you're getting some validation. You're not a crazy person after all.
That was the turning point for me. It was really the turning point for me because here we had a doctor, a clinical nutritionist, a PhD, who understood what I was experiencing. He dealt with thousands of people with these kind of complaints and disorders. And he said to me, as bad as you feel, he says, I've seen people worse get well. And I said, oh, am I going to get well? And he said, yes, you're going to get well. And he says, if you can get 80% well, I would consider that a recovery. And it took us 5 years of hard work, but I'm 100% well.
Yes.
We made it. Thank you. And, you know, I shouldn't share my age because ladies shouldn't do that, but I work like I'm in my 30s. You know what I mean? I've recovered my energy and my capacity to travel, and I speak now all around the United States, and I'm even asked to come to Australia to speak in next April, perhaps, if things work out, on behalf of, you know, inspiration and recovery from these kind of illnesses, that it can happen.
Yes, yes. Well, well done. Thank you for going to do that, you know, and perhaps we'll catch up when you're down under.
Oh, I'd love that.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, you know, 5 years, it sounds like a long time. It sounds like a long time to some people. Tell me, did you, I mean, I assume you went on to the medication for the Lyme disease. Probably
no,
for a period of time,
this,
no?
This is an interesting piece of the story.
Mm-hmm.
In the United States, most people go on to antibiotic therapy for Lyme disease because it is caused by a bacterial infection.
Mm-hmm.
But, and I thought that's what we were going to do because they put you on an intravenous feed for these older infections like that when it's into the neurological system. And the nutritionist said to me, Katina, I would think twice about that.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, really, why? And he says, it's not proven that the long-term antibiotics have a certain cure.
Mm-hmm.
He says, some people do respond to them. Some people are dependent upon them for like a decade, and some people actually get worse.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, the antibiotics are perfect in a brand new infection that's just a few weeks or a couple of months old, like that summer I got sick in 2000.
Mm-hmm.
He says, because then the antibiotics work when it's right there in your bloodstream and they catch the bacteria before it starts spiraling its way into the organs and the glands and the tissues. He said, but my recommendation is this. And he says, I approach this kind of illness with three prongs. One, he says, I want to get your body to start detoxifying. Because he says you've got a lot of toxic buildup from the Lyme bacteria and also from all of this dysfunction of the mitochondria and from the inflammation in your digestive tract. He says you've got leaky gut syndrome. And he says you're just very toxic. So I want to start cleansing your bloodstream, your kidneys, your tissues, which he did with herbs and with homeopathic therapies. And he changed my diet. Like we cut out all wheat. And I'd already not been a meat eater, but we took out sugar and wheat, and I did not eat much dairy either, but I was really just vegetable and
right.
Simple proteins, and he started this detoxification program. Then he said, the second thing is, I think in your case, because we do know the bacteria is present, let's use the herbs. There's herbs from the Amazon and also herbs, teasel root, is a Native American plant, and there's other herbs that will kill the bacteria. He says they don't have nearly the side effects
right.
of the antibiotics, and they won't destroy your good flora in
yeah.
your digestive tract, which was already an issue. And then you'd get a whole nother level of yeast, and I already had the whole mold thing going. And then he said the third prong was then, which I think was very, very essential, Dan, and I think this is one of the big reasons I recovered. And he said, I want to do special metabolic profile tests,
mm-hmm.
and I want to use these specialty labs, again, you know, out-of-pocket expense, but I didn't, at this point, it was like, who cared? I was selling the house anyway. I needed to get well.
Sure.
So we did these metabolic tests, and we looked at, like, my, you know, function of different glands, the adrenal function, the pancreatic function, the status and inflammation of my digestive tract, my neurotransmitters, the essential fatty acids. He did these like whole different, you know, system complex analysis and found out where all the depletions were.
Mm-hmm.
And so then when he kind of, you know, put it all together like a giant puzzle, and we discovered, you know, a vitamin D was like terrible. It was like a 20. I had like no magnesium. My B complex vitamins were gone. My essential fatty acids and the amino acids were totally depleted.
Mm-hmm.
And I told you we had that mitochondria ATP thing that wasn't running right. And I had all this inflammation. I mean, it was like a mess. No wonder why I felt like hell. So, you know, step by step, he says, we can't tackle it all at once because it's, you know, we just have to be, you know, methodical. Mm-hmm. So we did the detox and we added in, you know, some restorative things like the B vitamins and the D, and we worked on, you know, cleaning up my system, and then we brought in the herbs. But, I mean, it was really like every other month I was visiting him. Mm-hmm. And working on these regimes, and then I weekly was visiting an acupuncturist because he felt, and I agreed too, that the acupuncture would help bring down the inflammation.
Right.
It would help start balancing, you know, different, you know, systems of the body. And so I was very devoted to the whole thing, and many of my friends said to me they would not have had the patience I did, because both he and then my medical doctor, who was an integrative physician from England, actually, he had said to me, I still want you on another year of bed rest. Mm. Even though we've started the regime, he says, you're so fragile and your nervous system is so depleted. He says, you just can't be running around town and going to the movies and going into the big supermarket with all those bright lights. And he says, you just need, if we had a facility where I could put you for a rest cure, he said, that's where I would put you, but we don't have such things anymore in the United States, really, well, that are...
That's right, because chronic fatigue syndrome, fibromyalgia, has been around for a long time. And in the past, this is what they used to do. They used to just send you somewhere to rest. They used to have a special home, sit there, you know, looking at the back garden or the nice thing, a warm blanket in the sunshine. And have meals brought to you. It sounds like a long holiday, but obviously it's nowhere near that glamorous. But yeah, these sort of convalescent type homes, they just don't exist these days, and people don't realize the importance of appropriate caring and lifestyle as part of the healing process. So that's very pertinent.
And that was a very big piece I had to embrace, and it was hard for me, Dan, because I mean, I've been sick for all those years and on the sofa and the bed, and I felt like, oh gosh, well now we found some things out, so maybe I can get up and go. And so when they said to me, no, you need to be in deep rest, your nervous system, the adrenal glands, everything needs to be restored, and you have to just, you know, do a lot of quiet reading, and I was already meditating to begin with. But then I started with even more, you know, more kind of visualization tapes and anything that I could get my mind to go in a positive direction.
And look, again, I think what you're saying here is very interesting and insightful, because it is very, very easy to fall into the trap of wanting to get back into things. So, you know, like you say, you've been lying there on the couch for years. You finally got the energy. I mean, talk about a, you know, pent up lust for life. You want to go and do stuff. And I think many people fall into that trap, that as soon as they start to feel better, they're back into trying to live life fully. And they're also sometimes back into the old habits. Mm. Old habits of not living life fully, but living life irresponsibly. And, and then they get sick again and they go, see, I knew this wasn't going to work. So what people don't recognize is that when we rebuild the bodily systems, everything from, as you're talking about, your mitochondrial dysfunction to your glandular, you know, rebuilding. It's not when you're feeling well. It's not as you start to feel well that the benefit happens. It's whilst you're feeling well and you're not pushing. It is that is the time that healing actually happens. So people think, oh, I feel terrible and now I feel better, so the healing has happened. No. The healing is now starting. So when you're feeling better and you're now resting, even though you could do more, it's about doing less than you could. It is that difference between what you could do and what you do that kind of think about as filling up your bucket. And that is the time that we do the deep, deep healing. And I think one of the key ways people fall down is they don't heal fully. You know, you can go up to 80% or 70% or whatever and you feel good, and then you're just back into the cycle of pushing and getting unwell again. it's important to go all the way.
All the way, yes.
All the way. Bring it all home. All the way.
Yeah, and you know what? There was this point for me. You know, I had to sell the house, and I moved with my son. We went into this little a front half of an old Victorian house in our downtown in a little village that we live in. And it was a tiny little space, but I liked it. It was charming, and it was easy because the doctor had me on bed rest still, and they said, I don't want to see that card of yours driving on the streets of town.
Yes.
And, you know, I had to get friends, and they had to help, and I got a teenager. Teenagers are great helpers, you know, to do things like go to the store for me and this and that. And my son, he would take his little scooter, and he would go get, you know, something at the post office or go get something at the video store. And, you know, we were right in the, and I on purpose found this little place in town so he could help out. And I recall a friend of mine was going through the same illness at the same time as me. I was 1 year more advanced. I got sick in 2000. She got sick in 2001, but she did not do the rest cure.
No.
And she kept saying, well, I have to drive. I don't have anyone else to get the boys here or there. And I said, well, you have to make the lifestyle changes. Like, I sold my house. I made these changes because the doctor said if I want to get well, I have to rest 100%. And she says, well, I can't sell my house. I said, well, you can. You just don't want to. Mm. You know, or she said, well, I can't find someone to drive the children. I said, well, I did. You can. Look, you know, there are people around. You just, so she was, like, fighting it. Like, she didn't want to really, you know, do, like you said, all the way.
Because the point is this. You can do all that stuff. You now look at what you can do. You can get your kids.
Oh, yeah.
You can do all this stuff. But it's false economy. You know, if you can get fully well, you can do what you want. But it is, you know, if you keep pushing and you never get well, it's just false economy. It's false economy. But the difference is this. Yeah, it's all nice and good for you to tell me the story, Katina, and maybe that worked for you. But if it wouldn't work for me, then what's the point? And I think this is the big leap of faith, because, yeah, it all sounds nice and good, and, oh, well, you had Lyme disease, you didn't actually have chronic fatigue syndrome or fibromyalgia, nudge, nudge, wink, wink. Obviously, that's not the case, but you see, we hear other people's stories, and then we think, oh, well, you know, that worked for you, but it's not going to work for me, and obviously, there's some element of truth to that in the sense that perhaps we need to do some other things, but I have to tell you, I hear the core strategies time and time and time again. It's like a broken record, okay? And so I hope the listeners are taking that on board, is that these things that are not necessarily quick fixes, they're not sexy, they're not exciting, they're still, they need to be done. They need to be
Well, yes, thank you, Dan, for driving that home for the listeners, because, you know, I learned a lot about myself, obviously. I learned a lot about healing. I learned a lot about the human being during this 10-year journey. And, you know, a couple of pieces that came to me were, number one, I realized in that little house when I was there with my son with the scooter and everything, I realized, well, gosh, you know, I've been miserable and complaining and so sad that I haven't been out in the world. But you know what? People pay thousands and thousands of dollars to go to retreats and monasteries and ashrams, and they, you know, they turn over their careers and all kinds of things to go to retreat and find an oasis and an inner sanctuary, and by going to a real sanctuary. And so I realized, I said to myself, this is your retreat.
Absolutely.
You have been, you know, given this opportunity. It came through an illness, and this is your ashram. This is your sanctuary, and I am being asked to make a journey to my soul center. And I didn't have the privilege of going to a monastery or an ashram and having a guru or a guide there to teach me. But I realized, well, I can do this. I can visit in, I can go in, I can contemplate, I can see what nature or divinity or God, whatever language works for you, is being asked of me, because something is being asked of me that is requiring me to change. I can't be living the life that I was living before, that multitasking, you know, high energy, externalized life of high achievement and, you know, juggling all the balls at once. I'm being asked to change, and I took this time out. Mm. And that's what it became for me. And it really was an interesting time, because I found a spiritual teacher, a lovely older woman who was very wise. And we talked a lot about, you know, some of the things in my life that I thought were important, but were they really that important? And it ended up becoming a time where I really did make some big changes internally as well as externally.
Katina, you know, what you say is very pertinent. I hope people are listening very closely to you. You know, these kind of distinctions can sound a little bit confronting. They can sound a bit, what does this really have to do with anything? Because you had Lyme disease, and then that triggered your illness, so why are you talking about this? And I'll try and give the framework for people to make those connections of why that happens. Because I think what you're saying here, and I hope people are listening very carefully, is very, very insightful. And inevitably, whenever I speak to people who've recovered, they talk about these aspects. So sometimes they volunteer them. Most of the time they volunteer them. Sometimes I sort of dig a bit deeper. But inevitably, it's there. Do you think, looking back, that it was the Lyme disease, that you had Lyme disease, and that's why you were ill? Or do you think it was some other combination?
I think it was a combination. I think I've learned a lot about Lyme disease since because it is truly a situation that is exploding around the world. I think it is an epidemic that is of the new century, the way it was HIV in the 1980s. Before that, it was polio. Before that, you know, it was diphtheria, tuberculosis. I mean, like every 30 or 40 years, there is an epidemic and infectious illness that hits like Western society. Mm-hmm. So I don't discredit the Lyme, but this is what I'd like to say. Why do some people maybe get infected with the Lyme bacteria, mm-hmm. and they get just a mild infection, and they have a few weeks of aches and pains and a fever, and they recover quickly, or they take the antibiotics and they pop right out of it? Or then there's other people like myself who maybe get infected with that bacteria or something else, a mycoplasma, and we get tragically ill the way I was. So I think that it's more than just the bacteria. It was some of it, like we said, maybe some of my genetic predisposition. Maybe I do have some, you know, nervous system or genetic predisposition for, like we said, the mitochondria dysfunction. And also, you know, I know this sounds maybe far out for some people, but a life is a journey, and we are presented with challenges. And I'm a high achiever. I'm the type that would push through things, and, you know, I have to do the best job at whatever it was I did. And I think the way for me to learn some of the lessons in life, it had to come through an illness, mm-hmm. because I was going to muscle my way through any other kind of challenge. Mm-hmm. So I think it's part and parcel. I think, you know, yes, I did get the bacteria in my system, but like you were asking me at the very beginning of our talk, what happened before leading up to it? You know, the situation with my mother, the stress, having a child at an older age. I mean, you know, maybe all of these things together affected me physiologically and emotionally. Mm-hmm. And I also think it was a life challenge for me.
Mm. Well, look, I think at this point, for those people listening, I should ask the question. Sometimes I ask this of the people I've interviewed. Have you actually read my book, CFS Unraveled?
No, I haven't.
Okay, that's fine. Now, the only reason why I asked that, Katina, is I don't want people thinking that the interview is staged, you know. This interview is just with the person, and I always have the interview with people. Everyone has their own story of recovery, how they did it, and I just asked a question. So I just wanted to clear that one up. Katina, before we go, just to wrap up, what would you say to somebody with the illness? What would be your message, and what would be your advice? If there was one thing, if you had like 1 minute to impart the most important message to someone, what would you say to them?
Oh, gosh. Well, I'd like to say three things. Number one, find a good integrative healthcare practitioner that understands about those metabolic profile tests that were so helpful for me in rebuilding depletions. No matter what your condition is, the body is very resilient, and if it's given the right restorative supplements, foods, materials, your body can rebuild. Number two, the power of our mind and our belief system is instrumental for survival and for thriving. And I think the reason I was able to move beyond the illness and come back and out into the world, besides the rest and all those other things, is because I really used my mind and my intention, the way my dad said, and then ultimately my spiritual teacher helped me. So, I mean, I think those are two really key pieces that cannot be dismissed. You can't just be a patient that's looking for someone to fix you from the outside. Someone can help you. That good integrative medicine doctor or a good naturopath or whomever, they can help you, but you have inner resources and you have tools. We are be given will, we have heart, we have intention, we have belief, and those are mighty, powerful energies. Absolutely. And they all work. They all work. And then the final little note is, because I do know Lyme disease is surging, it's worth a good test from a good lab.
Absolutely. Look, and there is a tremendous overlap. And, you know, Lyme disease is not always easily diagnosed. But then again, neither is chronic fatigue syndrome or fibromyalgia.
Right.
Well, I think there could be, but the appropriate tests that look at the root cause don't tend to be done. Hopefully you get there one day. But basically the issue with Lyme disease is difficult to diagnose and challenging to treat, and the overlap in symptoms with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia is huge. It's not just an overlap in symptoms, but Lyme disease is basically a trigger. It can often be a trigger,
right,
for people. But I'd like to put forward this suggestion. It's my view that it is not always a trigger at all. When people have Lyme disease, it's not necessarily a trigger for the chronic fatigue syndrome or fibromyalgia. It is something that happens afterwards. And I think that we get these exposures to this and many viruses and mycoplasms and all this type of thing, but it is the depleted body. If you're looking at somebody who is in the end stages of cancer, or any severe illness, dying in hospital, they've got a whole bunch of problems.
Mm-hmm.
They'll have all kinds of viruses, they'll have bacterial,
right,
infections, they'll have parasitic infections. That's because the body's not working. And so I hope that once people recognize this link and that they can use this to help their body restore, that they don't get caught up in saying, hey, I've got this thing, and because of that, until I fix this with whatever, you know, I can't get well. Or once I've done that, I'm going to be all hunky-dory. Because unfortunately, it doesn't work that way. It just doesn't work that way. As you experienced, obviously, in your own experience. And I know you didn't take the antibiotics, but you know, whether you take antibiotics or herbs, the point is that it's much more involved than just a lot of bacteria.
Oh, yeah. Well, you heard 5 years of my healing journey, and I integrated so many pieces, and, you know, it was a big day. I remember when the doctor allowed me to start walking, and then, you know, we added swimming a year later, and, you know, there was a lot of restorative work, yoga, and a lot of pieces went into my,
yes,
rebuilding and restoration, and I want to say that the human body and the human spirit is extremely,
yes,
resilient,
yes,
and that's my wish for others, is if I can offer hope and inspiration to you that, you know, life is filled with miracles and opportunities and wonderful people that can help you on your journey and on your process. And, you know, that's why I'm happy to speak with you today, Dan, and help go to other groups and give people hope. And, and inspire them to hold on and to reach out and not be afraid, and don't expect it to be a quick fix, but that it is a journey.
Mm. Katina, thank you very much for making the time to share your story. I think it's brave. I think you're very inspirational, and I hope people do get the hope from hearing your story. I know that you are very passionate, like myself, about helping people. I think there's a lot of us who go through this and come out the other end and recover and feel passionate about helping others. And I think the reason for that is quite simply that it is such an awful, harrowing experience. And and even when you're telling your story, and you know, I can't help but get emotional and quite manly, but perhaps a little teary, because it brings back your own experiences that are just the same. And when we come out the other end, we want to help and we want to pay it forward. And I thank you very much for doing that.
Thank you for having me, Dan. And do you know too that
I have a website and a book. That's right.
Right, shares my story.
Absolutely. And for the people who are listening to this, I wanted to actually, I will put in a link at the bottom of this interview so that they can find your webpage. And then you guys can have a look and get more detail on Katina's story and her insight that she shares. Obviously, the interview is only a glimpse into that. I'm sure that especially those people who have interest in Lyme disease will want to have a good look at that. So I will give all the details for that at the bottom. I believe, what was the title of your book again?
Out of the Woods.
Out of the Woods.
Out of the Woods. And I have a blog site, too, that you'll find on my website where we share our healing journeys.
Yes.
And it's a very, the blog is a wonderful place for people to share their stories and their hopes and fears. And it's all about just what you said, place for us all to hold hands together. And
absolutely, absolutely. Well, look, the more positive messages we get, the better it is. So thanks a lot. Thanks again for your story, and hopefully we get a chance to speak again soon.
And maybe even meet in Australia.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Wonderful. Thank you.
Cheers. Bye.